My talk today is going to be purely on depression because I was told that Dr. Suresh Kumar spoke about anxiety a couple of weeks back. So I'll start my lecture briefly by introducing some of the recent technologies and how it has transformed the practice of psychiatry. And then I will go into the problem of depression, the types of depression, the treatment of depression, where we stand today, and I'll end the talk with my take-home message. Now, when I started practice in 1975, psychiatry was still in its infancy. In fact, in any other branch of medicine, you had something to show to the patient. If you had a fracture, you would show him an x-ray and tell him this is the fracture. If you have a consolidation in lung, you would show him a lung film and say there's consolidation. If you have epilepsy, you show him an EEG and show the distorted patterns. But unfortunately, in psychiatry, we had nothing to show. It was such a stigmatized branch, and we used to treat symptoms in psychiatry. Insomnia, psychomotor retardation, and all the symptoms. And unfortunately, it was very difficult to convince, and a lot of practitioners said it's all in the mind, you know, you can take care of it. And the concept of biochemical nature of the illness and the stigma never prevented people to come forward and accept psychiatric treatment right away. It's no longer so. Now, we have today brain imaging, the functional SPET scans, which tells us exactly what neurotransmitters are involved in the brain and how we can choose molecules and substances for treating various types of psychiatric illnesses. So, functional brain imaging shows how the brain actually works. Now, SPET scans are very useful in showing us what really happens in the brain. Now, SPECT scan became very popular in America when Professor Amen, a psychiatrist in America, actually started doing a lot of work on SPECT scan. He started using very powerful gamma cameras with computerization and started looking at what is really happening in the brain. Now, how did he come about doing this? He had three children and all of them had attention deficit disorder. Now, he himself had adult attention deficit disorder, and he started looking at brain critically. He went on, though he was a psychiatrist, he went on to pass the American boards in radiology and started radiological work, right, honestly, using SPECT scan and gamma camera. Now, what's happening is, he started showing films on what really happens to the brain. And he started, for the first time, he brought out information that attention deficit disorder, hyperkinetic disorder, is not a single disease. He found out by his research, there are five types of attention deficit disorders. Some affecting the temporal lobe, where you have to use anticonvulsants. Some using the frontal lobe, where you have to use the SSRI. Some affecting the GABA processes, where you have to use anti-anxiety medication. And he went on to show a lot of such research, which threw open a lot of treatment options in attention deficit disorder. It didn't stop here. He went on to show how useful these cameras are to choose molecules in depression and schizophrenia. In fact, I use some of his slides to show patients how and really what happens to patients when they take ganja. Now, if you normally say ganja doesn't affect anyone, so if you take a SPECT scan, you are shown photographs what happens when you take ganja and the problems that occurs in the brain. What happens when you don't take medicines in schizophrenia, stop medicines for 3 months, restart medication, what is the difference in PET scans? So such educative scans are very useful in educating and showing patients what really happens inside the brain. So this is one other couple study which Eamon brought up. This is a couple in America where they had marital therapy for 3 years. And then with PET scan, he was able to show that the wife was having obsessive compulsive disorder, was over focused, and the husband had attention deficit disorder, and both of them had a wonderful combination. She was stickler for details and he had attention deficit where he couldn't really give attention to what she was mentioning. So putting him on Adderall and putting her on SSRI solved the problem. 3 years of massive therapy was put to an end by just starting them on medication. Now he went on to show in PET scan how various types of depression has various areas of brain affected, so you can choose your molecule depending on where the affection is. Now let's go on to depression. Depression affects about 10% of individuals at some time during their lives. 25 to 35% patients fail to respond, and the suicide rate is as high as 15%. By 2020, depression will become the most commonest health problem in developing countries. It was already found in 2010 that depression will be the second most common health problem next to heart disease. Now, this is what happens in normal depression. A normal mood, depression, and during 6 to 9 months of treatment, usually there is relapse. And then even after years of treatment, 1 year of treatment, you still have recurrence. Now, relapse occurs when there is not a full functional recovery. And even after functional recovery, sometimes the response is inadequate and a patient shows recurrence. Now, people with the first episode of depression has a 50% chance of recurrence. When they have 2 episodes, the recurrence rate goes up to almost 80 to 90%. When they have a third episode, then it becomes over 90%. So when we have patients with a genetic history with a relapse of 2 or 3 times, invariably, they have to continue medication almost for life. I tell my clients when they stabilize well, they are on 1 or 2 tablets, they constantly become functionally so normal, they ask me, when do we stop the medication? I tell them, I don't think we can ever stop the medication because you have a family history, and even slight reduction may cause a relapse and will not bring about a good functional recovery. Now, I tell them that I don't go back to the eye doctor and tell, when will you remove my glasses? The least I could do is make a correction in the number, but I can't remove my glasses. Today, when you have 2 or 3 episodes, we have to tell them it becomes a biochemical illness of the brain. We have to tell them that it's like diabetes, it's like hypertension. They have to take long-term medication. And unless we make them understand that this is a long-term illness, and relapse will definitely bring down their functional recovery and keep relapsing, and they go into bipolar disorder, which could be a debilitating illness. Now let's come to the major depressive illness. Now you have depressed mood, loss of interest, sleep disturbance, appetite and disturbance in weight gain, low energy, poor concentration, memory, psychomotor agitation and retardation, feelings of guilt or worthlessness, and suicidal ideation. Now, at least 5 of the following symptoms should be present for at least 2 weeks during the same period, and either the first or the second symptom should be present. Now, if you look at the evidence for undertreatment of depressive disorders, this chart shows you that almost 59% have no medication at all of the depressive people. Only 19% have minor tranquilizers, 12% have antidepressant, and 11% have antidepressant and minor tranquilizers. Now, if you look at the models for depression, you'll find that several models have been explored. Now, you have environmental developmental insults to the brain, genetic factors, epigenetic factors, then membrane changes that afflictions that occur, brain inflammation has been considered, NMDA receptors, then you have increased activity, excitability of the GABA neurons, then there is also the increased phasic dopamine activity, then decreased dopamine phasic activity and tonic activity, then this reduces the brain plasticity. Then there is also an oxidative stress, then there is a cholinergic activity, serotonin. All of this ultimately leads to four major symptoms that we see in anxiety and depression. Anxiety, it leads to anxiety symptoms, somatic symptoms, sleep deficits and mood symptoms. So all of this, this is what we are focusing in treatment. But how this is produced at the end is caused by so many factors. Research is going on and there are so many pointers are happening leading to these four things that we are trying to treat. Now we look into depression proper. The types of depression are major depression, chronic depression, atypical depression, bipolar mood disorder and seasonal affective disorder. The diagnosis made on extensive patient and family history, blood test for hypothyroidism, the history of current medication and the DSM-4 classification, which I already showed you, one of the first two symptoms and five other symptoms. The causes we have seen earlier, that it is genetics, any loss and any history of medication. Coming to the treatment, psychotherapy, electroconvulsive therapy, natural alternatives, medications like SSRIs, MAO inhibitors, tricyclics, SNRIs, NDRIs and tetracyclics. Now a word about electroconvulsive therapy. Now I have been using electroconvulsive therapy ever since 1975. I find it a very very useful method and I don't use it as a last resort. In very severe cases of depression, where there is suicidal ideation, where there is poor response to medication, ECT is a very useful technique. In fact, there are people who are scared to take ECTs, but in well-established centers, ECT has a big role. Recently in Medscape, you had an article, Andrade had brought out this article, on ECT being given to a 100-year-old lady with aortic stenosis. She recovered very well and it was quite a safe procedure. What I am trying to tell you is that this is ECT in safe hands where they use the latest technology can be a very useful way of treatment for resistant cases, for suicidal ideation, for people who are non-responders to medication and who have a lot of side effects to medication. In fact, in Mayo Clinic, there are certain centers in America where ECT is followed and there are groups of patients who refuse to take medication. There are people who come, they say when they get into a spell of depression every few years, they don't believe in taking the maintenance dose of medication. They will go to the Mayo Clinic, take 5 ECTs and then get back to work. We have a set of patients in Chennai who regularly, when they have a relapse, they come to Raja Nursing Home on Monday, Wednesday, Friday. Even if I tell them there are good medications, they have said no, they have come on an empty stomach. They would take a maintenance ECT for 3 ECTs and go away. Because they know that it brings them back to action. Their functionality improves so much, they are from village, they go back to work and then continue the maintenance dose of medication. Now I have to tell a story about a person who came much earlier. In fact, he had a family disorder, a mood disorder. The father had treatment under me for mood disorder. And he was on lithium, a very good responder for ECT. Now his son was in IIT and he was in the fourth year, doing very well, developed depression. The father brought him back and in fact he was supposed to take the examination 2 weeks later and he insisted that I give him ECTs. He said, my son will not take his examination if you don't give him ECTs. So I gave him ECTs and he said he doesn't have to prepare for the examination, he just have to give the examination, he will do well. Now he responded, he did the examination, did well, he's now in America doing well there. And he's continuing, the mood stabilizes. Now people who are responders are very good responders. And it is very useful as a tool to treat depression. How it acts, we really don't know. But it improves brain plasticity, there's something it does, and it does wonders. So people who are responders, it's still an excellent treatment. Now, we'll start off with the old tricyclics, which has been used for the last 2-3 decades. Now, the tricyclics are actually called as dirty drugs because of the side effects, because of their multiple mechanisms of action. Unfortunately, it causes REM suppression. There is no effect on disrupted circadian rhythms. There is a discontinuation syndrome, and there is sexual dysfunction. Now, these are the side effects, so it's not very popular. I still use it. It's not very expensive. It's very cheap. People who tolerate tricyclics do very well on tricyclics and are still very useful. Though it has side effects, people who tolerate it, it's still an excellent medication. Now, the TCAs that are in the market are some of these. I'm sure all of you are familiar, except the last two, which is the last one. All of this have been available, and some of you are still using some of these molecules: amitriptyline, desmitriptyline, doxepine, imipramine, nortriptyline, and trimipramine. Now, it acts on the serotonin and norepinephrine and dopamine transmitters. It allows the degradation of the postsynaptic receptors. Now, the side effects are muscarinic, anticholinergic, including dry mouth, blurred vision, constipation, urinary retention, impotence, histamine causing sedation, weight gain, adrenergic alpha receptors causing postural hypertension, direct membrane effects causing lowered seizure threshold, arrhythmias, then 5-H2 receptor antagonism causing weight gain and reduced anxiety. Now, TCA side effects also includes cardiotoxicity, increased LDH leakage, so cardiac conduction, high potency may make a person switch into mania, from bipolar depression to mania. So one has to use this with caution. Now, the tetracyclic antidepressants like mirtazapine, now this is a useful molecule which gives good sleep. So people who want a little extra sleep can use mirtazapine. But unfortunately, people who are diabetic, one has to use it with caution because you need to look at the metabolism. It causes weight gain, so you have to use it appropriately, cautionately, in especially in female patients where you have a threat of a great weight gain, who have metabolic problems, you have to use it with caution. Now, SSRIs, most commonly prescribed class. These are newer antidepressants. They are clean compared to the dirty drugs, but produce a much improved side effect profile, but not improved antidepressant efficacy. The drugs that are available are citalopram, duloxetine, escitalopram, fluoxetine, fluoxamine, paroxetine, sertraline. The side effects are anhedonia, apathy, nausea, vomiting, drowsiness, headache, biting of the teeth, excessive vivid and strange dreams, dizziness, fatigue, changes in sexual behavior, suicidal thoughts. Side effects are usually they are at the start of the treatment but disappear by about 4 weeks due to adaptation. More manageable compared to MAOIs and tricyclics. Sexual side effects are common. SSRI, cessation syndrome, the brain is zapped, and there is a sexual dysfunction. Serotonin, norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor, SNRIs. This is venlafaxine and duloxetine. Now we have the desvenlafaxine. Now they have greater efficacy than SSRIs, slightly fewer adverse effects. Mechanism of action are very similar to SSRIs. Side effects are similar to SSRIs, with suicide in the initial part of the treatment. Although serotonin can mediate numerous therapeutic actions, too much serotonin can cause dangerous toxicity like anxiety, insomnia, GI disturbance, sexual dysfunction. Too little of serotonin can cause depression. Now I brought this slide because, you know, in yet another platform where I was discussing about pain and depression, you know, physicians and general practitioners generally use duloxetine because it was projected as very useful for painkiller. Now duloxetine, here this slide shows how the pain is relieved, but the patient is very unhappy. You know, there is an underlying depression which is unaddressed. Duloxetine can remove the pain, but if there is underlying depression which is unattended, he is still a very unhappy person and doesn't come back to functional activity. Norepinephrine dopamine reuptake inhibitors, NDRS. This is the bupropion valbutrin, which is very popular in America for smoking cessation. It's similar to SSRIs, SNRIs. Now, more potent and inhibiting their dopamine. Now, this the side effects are it lowers the seizure threshold, suicidal ideation in the initial start of the treatment. I choose this molecule especially where you have a female patient who is interested in not to have a weight gain and who has a smoking tendency and who is particularly interested in sexual dysfunction as a side effect of antidepressants. Now coming back to the broader guidelines of depression treatment, one should raise the awareness, disease awareness, reduce stigma, encourage help-seeking behavior. We have looked at three molecules, neurotransmitters, in regulation of mood. One is the dopamine, the other is norepinephrine, the other is serotonin.
How are you? Can you open the door?
70% of the patients do not achieve remission following adequate treatment and they require a second antidepressant. Now, I didn't talk much about MAOI inhibitors because it's not available in this country and its side effects of hypertensive crisis is so huge and we cannot use it because we use curds regularly in our diet. So I didn't talk much about it because those molecules are not available. I spoke about TCAs, I spoke about SSRIs, I spoke about other molecules. I will end my lecture by introducing this molecule agomelatine, which is an atypical antidepressant. This is a molecule which is going to be introduced today, and six companies are introducing this molecule this week in this country. This shows a lot of promise, and we just have a slide about this molecule. Agomelatine mode of action. Now, there is no influence on the extracellular serotonin level, no effect on the monoamine uptake. This is a melatonin T1 and T2 receptor agonist which acts on the suprachiasmatic nucleus where the biological clock that controls the circadian rhythm is located. Agomelatine is a selective antagonist of the 5-HT2C receptor in the frontal lobe of the brain and the suprachiasmatic nucleus. Agomelatine has shown to resynchronize the disrupted circadian rhythms in patients with major depressive disorder, and this may manifest clinically as improvements in mood, anxiety, and sleep-awake cycles. I end my talk by a take-home message. I find a lot of physicians using alprazolam as anti-anxiety molecule. I request they don't use this molecule because of abuse potential. You prescribe one or two tablets, but they continue it with 6, 7, 8, 9, and they end up to us being addicted to this molecule and become very difficult to withdraw this molecule. So avoid, use lorazepam as a substitute, but not alprazolam because of its strong addictive potential. It's very difficult to withdraw the molecule. Avoid serenase. You know, serenase 0.25 milligram is prescribed. Just 3 days back, I had a patient who had some infection, had antibiotic. Because she was taking my medication, they said she was feeling a little restless and out of sorts. And the physician had prescribed serenase 0.25 milligram twice daily. She came to me in three days later with akathisia. She was not able to sit, she was not able to sleep, she had extreme pain. I had to withdraw serenase and put her on finerenone, another medication, lorazepam, to control the symptoms. So serenase in low dosage, though anti-anxiety, can cause akathisia and should be used very cautiously. Never withdraw antidepressants suddenly. Severe withdrawal symptoms, danger of suicide is very common. Start treatment early, increase dosage gradually, refer to psychiatrist if symptoms don't settle down. Complete treatment saves lives and improves the qualities of life tremendously. Thank you.
Please stay there to take any questions, sir. Floor is open for discussion.
Is there any particular reason why the low dosage haloperidol causes akathisia, especially akathisia, or any extra preventive?
Actually, even high doses, very high doses cause, and sometimes high doses and sudden withdrawal causes it. It's the dopamine blockage, you know, and it's not in all patients you have. There are some patients who are susceptible for akathisia, you know, like even other toxicity of neuromyelitis syndrome and other dystonias. You know, this is not common in all. I use it so frequently, but it has in some patients, and patients who have it suffer very much. So, because general practitioners tend to use it quite freely, I'm cautioning because this can be incapacitating. It's so painful. They can't sleep, they are not able to sit, they are not able to sleep, they keep pacing up and down, and the whole family gets traumatized. It's such a very painful condition, you know, one needs to really go through it and see the suffering. It's very painful. I don't know the answer, but I think it's the dopamine blockage, you know, and sudden release of it causes the surge.
Insomnia is a part of the depression. Insomnia?
Yes.
It's a part of the depression. Will it become alright with the antidepressants alone? Or does it need a separate sleeping pill?
Actually, yet another platform where I had spoken about zolpidem molecule, where people were talking about zolpidem being so useful in a lot of other conditions, even improving the condition of diabetes and other metabolic conditions. Because you know, if you really look at the sympathetic and the parasympathetic, you know, the stressors, the first thing that happens is the sleep circadian rhythms. And today you have a lot of this. Because in IT workers, in BPO workers, etc., who are stressed out because that, you know, the slow wave sleep, you know, we were talking of REM sleep as important. But today we know in sleep research cycle, the slow wave sleep is such an important thing as a regenerating factor in health. And we know that this molecule agomelatin at the suprachiasmatic nucleus helps in improving the slow wave sleep. And if the slow wave sleep is increased, then the rejuvenation takes place. All of us know that if we miss on the slow wave sleep, we feel exhausted, we feel tired, we feel totally out of sorts. So, in a way, they say that by improving this, it can address a lot of problems. But we need to see whether it really shows the promise. There are a lot of speculations, but we have to use the molecule to see, we know whether it's that effective. But it's come with a lot of promise.